unknowable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 115, recorded late in October in the autumn Danish forest. And you are indeed welcome to questions on karma, intentional action caused by contact. Thank you.
Friends, what are the seven links to awakening? The seven Sambuyankas. They are 1. The awareness linked to awakening. Sati Sambuyanka. 2. The investigation linked to awakening. Dhammavichaya Sambuyanka. 3. The energy linked to awakening. Viriya Sambuyanka. 4. The joy linked to awakening. Piti Sambuyanka. 5. The tranquility linked to awakening. Pasati Sambuyanka. 6. The concentration linked to awakening. Samadhi Sambuyanka. 7. The equanimity linked to awakening. Upekka Sambuyanka. These are the 7 links leading to final enlightenment, freeing from all addiction, are these 7 links to awakening. The Blessed Buddha once said, "Bhikkhus, I do not see even one other single thing that when developed and cultivated leads to the eliminations of the things that bind so effectively and quickly as these 7 links to awakening." What 7? 1. The awareness linked to awakening. 2. The investigation linked to awakening. 3. The energy linked to awakening. 4. The joy linked to awakening. 5. The tranquility linked to awakening. 6. The concentration linked to awakening. 7. The equanimity linked to awakening. How, Bhikkhus, are these 7 links to awakening developed and refined so that they lead to the giving up and letting go of those things that bind? Here, when a Bhikkhu develops these 7 links to awakening, joined with and dependent upon seclusion, dissolution, and ceasing, culminating in surrender and release, then these 7 links to awakening are refined and matured in a way so that they lead to the leaving of the things that bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings. And what are the things that bind, grip, addict, and obsess all beings? The eye, ear, nose, mouth, body, and mind are things that addict and obsess all beings. Forms, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, and ideas are things that addict and obsess beings. Seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, and thinking bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings. These are the phenomena that bind, ensnare, entrap, enslave, enchain, and consume beings. Freeing from this addiction are these 7 links to awakening indeed. The Blessed Buddha once said, "Bhikkhus, I do not see even one other single thing that when developed and cultivated leads to the elimination of the things that bind so effectively and quickly as these seven links to awakening. What seven? One, the awareness link to awakening. Two, the investigation link to awakening. Three, the energy link to awakening. Four, the joy link to awakening. Five, the tranquility link to awakening. Six, the concentration link to awakening. Seven, the equanimity link to awakening. How Bhikkhus are these seven links to awakening developed and refined so that they lead to the giving up and letting go of those things that bind? Yeah, here, when a Bhikkhu develops these seven links to awakening, joined with, dependent upon, seclusion, disillusion, and ceasing, culminating in surrender and release, then these seven links to awakening are refined and are matured to the leaving of things that bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings. And what are the things that bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings? The eye, ear, nose, mouth, body, and mind are things that addict and obsess beings. Forms, sounds, smells, tastes, touches, and ideas are things that addict and obsess beings. Seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, and thinking bind, grip, addict, and obsess beings. These are the phenomena that bind, ensnare, entrap, enslave, enchain, and consume beings. These seven links that frees from these addictions produce enlightenment. They lead to and induce enlightenment. Thus are they links to awakening. They are themselves enlightened, and this way they are links to awakening. They are enlightened since they embrace the root cause of awakening. They are enlightened since they provide and equip the cause of awakening. They are enlightened since they induce ripening of the cause of awakening. They are enlightened since they enhance the root cause of awakening. They are enlightened since they completely perfect the cause of awakening. How do these seven links to awakening remain established and anchored in the mind? The awareness link remains by no attention being given to other states. The awareness link remains by the sign of being directed to continuously. The awareness link remains by the signless state being given attention. The awareness link remains by no attention given to mental proliferations. The awareness link remains by attention being given to the ceasing of craving. The awareness link to awakening indeed remains fixed and anchored in mind in these five ways. Exactly and similarly so with the other six links to awakening. This is from the Path of Discrimination, the Pasita Sambhita Magga, and the links to awakening.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air number 115 from the autumn forest of Denmark, recorded in late October 2018. Remember, first of all, to click subscribe there so you get your ticket to Nirvana. Click the small bell there. Click the like button if you like. And the first advertisement is from the meditation course, Calm and Insight, a silent meditation retreat in North Carolina, Hendersonville, in December 2018. I can recommend you can participate any number of days you want from 0 to 12. All are welcome. you can go to whatbuddhasaid.net and click the silent retreat link. Thank you. The pictures you see here is from this retreat place, Hardwood Refuge, an old wooden hotel which seems to be very, very suitable for the course. And as I said, it will be both calm samatha and insight vipassana. All 40 meditation objects of the Buddha will be gone through, and we will practice in particular the six main of them. So much for the intro. No, we've forgotten. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. The first question goes like this. Anagārika is a middle way between lay life and monkhood. Yes, there is. There is Anagārika, which the famous one, which means a homeless one, was Anagārika Dharmapāla. He lived from 1964 to 1933, born on Sri Lanka. Dhammapala means protector of the Dhamma. And he founded the Theosophical Society together with Colonel Olcott, Henry Steele Olcott, and Helena Blavatsky, which you see here. And he also founded the Mahabodhi Society in Colombo, and which also is in Bodhgaya, to protect the Mahabodhi Temple in Bodhgaya, the place, the very place where the Buddha enlightened. He was a great reformer and revivalist of Sinhala Buddhism, and also one who toured together on the island together with Olcott, and made many Buddhist schools pop up. So the Buddhist Renaissance in Sri Lanka actually is much ascribed to this Anagārika Dharmapāla, the homeless one, which is a protector of the Dhamma. They live by 8 precepts, not 227, and they goes like this. The first are the formal 5. I undertake the precept to refrain from killing, and 2 from taking what is not given, that is stealing, and 3 from all sexual activity. This means that they not only celibate, but they also don't masturbate from their woe on life out. 4, I undertake to refrain from all incorrect speech, false speech, musavada, like lying, and incorrect speech, also scolding, empty gossip, and slandering, divisive speech. 5, I undertake the precept to refrain from intoxicating drinks and drugs causing carelessness. 6, I undertake the precept to refrain from eating at a forbidden time, that is after noon. So they eat from dawn to noon, not in the afternoon, or at the evening, or at night. 7, I undertake the precept to refrain from dancing, singing, music, entertainments, using perfume, garlands, and cosmetics. So no shows, no TV shows, no going to any games or anything like that. So they're fairly focused, and no cosmetics and beautification of the body. 8, I undertake the precept to refrain from lying on a high and luxurious sleeping place. So they lie on a low bed, or usually on Sri Lanka, they actually lie on the floor. As on Uposatha day, observance days, and these Anagārikas are usually their entire life. I'll cut in a small documentary about this very famous Anagārika Dharmapāla, and it comes right here.
After Gautama Buddha, there were a number of significant personalities born to the world to protect and propagate Buddha Dharma. Anagārika Dharmapāla is an iconic figure among them. Anagārika Dharmapāla was born in Colombo on the 17th day of September 1864, although his native village is Hittatiya in the southern province of Sri Lanka. Don Karolis Hewavitarana was his father, and Mallika Hewavitarana was his mother. He was the first child of his family, and the parents named him Don David Hevavitarana. He started his education in Baptist College, Demetagod, Kalambuten. Then he moved to St. Benedict's College, Christian College Kote, St. Thomas's College Modera, and finally the prestigious Royal College Colombo 7. As the latter is of a Christian background, he sought Buddhist and Pali education from Venerable Hikkaduwe Sri Sumangala and Venerable Heyantaduwe Devamitta Theros. Meanwhile, American national Colonel Henry Steele Olcott and Russian national Miss Helena Blavatsky made a formal conversion to Buddhism in Sri Vijayaratna Vihara, Valivatta, Sri Lanka. This deed was a blessing to Buddhists of the island because at the time Sri Lanka was under the British Empire, and as a result the Buddhists in Sri Lanka were harassed and segregated. Theosophical Society formed by Colonel Olcott built several Buddhist schools such as Ananda Colombo, Mahinda Gaul, Maliyadeva Kurunagala and Dharmaraja Kandy. They traveled the island preaching people their rights, and by hearing these awakening lectures, David Hevavitarana, alias Anagārika Dharmapāla, abandoned his Christian name David and changed his name as Dharmapāla Hevavitarana. Since then, he commenced a celibate life, starting a journey with Olcott to every corner of the island, preaching for a religious revival and renaissance. Due to his brave, honest, and straightforward lectures, he became the best orator of Sri Lanka that time. On invitation, Anagārika Dharmapāla participated in a World Religious Convention in Chicago in September 1893. There he addressed the gathering on the theme of Buddha's character, the Four Noble Truths, and the Eightfold Path, and the entire audience was mesmerized by his oration. One participant, Mr. Stewart, converted to Buddhism right after Anagārika Dharmapāla's speech, and he invited the latter later to conduct several lectures in many places there. This story was so popular that it was published in several papers in the US. On his way back at Honolulu Port, Anagārika Dharmapāla met Lady Mary Foster among the masses gathered to see him. Later, this lady, Mary Foster, helped in sizable donations to the Buddhist revival and propagation mission of Anagārika Dharmapāla. That time, Buddhism was almost swept away from its birthplace, India, and Buddhist shrines and temples were ruins and in chaotic situation. When he arrived in India, Isipatana was covered by thick jungle. The temples were destroyed. The ancient stone pillars were being carried away by the locals for their personal use. This plight was a great shock to Anagārika Dharmapāla. In 1902, he bought a land in Isipatana. He commenced construction of Mulagandikuti Vihara Shrine in 1928 and completed in 1930, despite protests and conspiracies of Brahmins. When he arrived in Buddhagaya in 1881, he saw that the premises was under the control of Hindu priest Mahanta. From there, he started a mission to safeguard Buddhagaya from the destructive forces and inaugurated Mahabodhi Society under the presidency of Venerable Hikkaduwe Sri Sumangala Thero. Their slogan in Sri Lanka was Sinhalayani negative Buddhagaya va beraganiu, meaning rise Sinhalese to save Buddhagaya. And this became a massive movement which led to buy a plot of land in Buddhagaya. A temple was built there and the Buddhist monks were invited to reside. Anagārika Dharmapāla led a brave struggle to get back the sacred premises to the Buddhists. He moved on to establish a Mahabodhi Society in Calcutta and constructed a Buddhist center called Dharmarajika Vihara. Indian government did not take this into serious consideration as the region was represented by majority of powerful Hindus. As a result of the Buddhist voices raised from all over the world, Buddhagaya cases legal proceedings commenced. It was decided at the courts of Calcutta that Buddhagaya's ownership must be for the Buddhists. This move was a historic and significant decision in the Buddhist history. The Buddhist world must be thankful to the efforts by Anagārika Dharmapāla whenever they visit the temple of Bodhgaya. Anagārika Dharmapāla delivered his final lecture in Sri Lanka in 1931 at Vidyodaya Pirivena and left for Dambadiva, India. On the 31st of July, Anagārika Dharmapāla was ordained as Venerable Sri Devamitta Dharmapāla and received higher ordination on the 17th of January 1933. Venerable Sri Devamitta Dharmapāla's noble service to the Buddhist world came to an end with his death on the 27th of April 1933.
Anagārika Dharmapāla Sri Nāme.
Ekasiya panas vasare.
Question 355. How do we stop someone taking advantage of our niceness and kindness? Yes, the first thing, one can avoid all abusers and all abuse. So that is to say, no contact, no problem, basically, insofar as that is possible. And the Buddha said about this alleviating all anger the following. There are, bhikkhus and friends, five methods of overcoming irritation whereby the anger and annoyance that has arisen in a bhikkhu may be overcome, stilled, quelled on the spot. Which are these five methods? 1. One should develop an all-embracing kind friendliness, metta. One should develop an all-embracing compassionate pity, karuna. One should develop an imperturbable and indifferent equanimity, upekkha. One should not pay him or her any attention or consideration at all. It is total neglect. Then the problem is gone. And 5. One should know the ownership of karma, that oneself and this person too is the owner and inheritor of the results of our actions. That oneself and this person too is created by the results of our actions. That oneself and this person too has the result of own action as destiny. In these 5 ways may the wise bhikkhu overcome his anger and hatred. Anguttara Nikaya, Book 5, Sutta 161. So this always goes with the case of abusers, that anger arise. So it's to quell this anger is the first thing. Do not let anger overpower you. Do not become angry with the angry. Do not become angry with the anger itself. Do not oppose anger itself. Noble ones always remain harmless. Their own hate crushes angry people, like a devastating mountain avalanche. And that's true. Not by anger is hate ever quenched. Only by kind friendliness is hate always quenched. This ancient law is an eternal truth, the Dhammapada. And the Buddha said, having slayed anger, you sleep in ease. Having killed anger, you do not grieve. No grief. The noble one prays the slaying of anger with its honeyed crest and poison root. For having killed it, you do not grieve. Samyutta Nikaya 1.171. So, for example, revenge. One says, sweet is the revenge. That is honeyed crest of the arrow. But it has a poison root that is bitter. So, when the revenge has been taken and the revenge comes back, then there's bitterness. So, anger is the only thing that is praised by the wise to be killed, slayed down, put down. Anger. Put down anger. What are the feeding cause that makes ill will arise? There are displeasing and repulsive features and aspects of any object, frequently giving irrational and unwise attention to them. This is the feeding cause of arising of unarising ill will, and also the feeding cause of the very increase and expansion of any ill will that already has arisen. So irrational, unwise attention to the repulsive features of any person or object. Disregarding them and seeing on the lovable, beautiful features that can be found in all beings, because they will go to, they have in their heart, they will be enlightened one day. This is the thing that quells anger. The three paranoid thoughts that induce resentment and anger. He or she has done, is doing now, or in the future will do me some wrong. One. Two. He or she has done, is doing now, or will in the future do somebody I like, my friends, some wrong. He or she will do my friends some wrong. Then anger arises. Me and my friends, they will do us some wrong, then anger arises. Last one, he or she has done, is doing now, or will do somebody I dislike some good. So he will help my enemies, basically. This is also a cause of anger arising. One should just be aware of these three causes, then one can categorize it into these three causes when anger starts knocking the door. Then one can see which of them, just classifying it, will make anger go down 50%. So much for anger or irritation amongst abusers. Question 356. Dhamma tells us to do good karma for liberation. However, good karma also leads us to pleasant and favorable situations and people. And there's always a danger of getting attached to such attractive things. So isn't it contradictory to attaining liberation via good karma? One cannot attain liberation only with good karma. And I'll explain in a minute why so. Because one always has an accumulation of bad karma, and this should be neutralized, and that's the purpose of good karma. Has one succeeded doing that, then neutralizing one's evil karma from the past, from the very distant past, many lives ago, many universes, cycles ago, then one should do karma to end karma. And these are the three or four kinds of karma there is. There's good karma, bad karma, mixed karma, good and bad karma, and karma to end all karma. This is the fourth. So, the Buddha on karma explained it like this. Karma is basically a law. It's a law about a moral or ethical efficacy of any action. The Buddha said about this, the cause by which karma comes into play should be known. The diversity in karma should be known. The result of karma should be known. The ending of karma should be known. The way of practice for the ending of karma should be known. Thus has it been said in reference to what was it said. Intention, I tell you, is karma. So is the intention behind the verbal, mental, or physical action that is the karma. The intention is the karma, not the action itself. It is the intention that determines the karma, and the ethical qualities or lack of thereof within this karma that determines the outcome, and thereby is the karma. Intending, one performs karma by way of body, speech and mind. And what is the cause by which karma comes into play? Contact is the cause by which karma comes into play. Contact, passa. Through the six senses, eye contact, ear contact, nose contact, tongue contact, bodily contact, or mental contact. Thinking about someone or something. Then one starts to act upon it. And this is the intention with this action, induced by this contact, that is the karma. And what is the diversity of karma? Having had sense contact, one generates a karmic intention. So contact is the cause by which karma comes into play. And what is diversity of karma? There's karma to be experienced as a future in hell. There's a karma to be experienced in the future of the various animals. There's a karma to be experienced in the realm of the hungry ghosts, the petas. There's a karma to be experienced as a future in the human world, manusaloka. And there's a karma to be experienced in the world of the divine devas, through the five destination, Panchakati. This is called a diversity in karma. And what is the result of karma? The result of karma is of three kinds, I tell you. That which arises here now, or later in this lifetime, or in subsequent later lives. That is called the result of karma. And what is the ending of karma? The ending of contact thereby also ends the accumulation of karma. The ending of contact. No contact, no intention, no intention, no karma. No karma, no future. No future, no rebirth. No rebirth, no aging, sickness and death. This verily is the end of suffering. The ending of contact thereby also ends the accumulation of karma. And what is the practice leading to the ending of karma? Just this noble eightfold way. Right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness and right concentration. That is the practice leading to the ending of karma. Now, when a disciple of the Noble Ones comprehends karma in this way, the cause, diversity, the result, the end, and the way of practice leading to the ending of karma in this way, then he sees the fulfillment of the noble life as the end of karma. So having completed the Noble Eightfold Way, then one ends karmic accumulation at the moment of awakening in whatever life it is. Then there's no more karmic accumulation. There might have been traces left from the past that has not been exhausted, but there's nothing further stacked up from that point on. Karma should be fully understood as intention. The cause of by which karma comes into play, contact, passa, the diversity in karma, hell, animal, real, peta, human, divine. The result of karma, this life, later lives, or later in this life. The ending of karma, the end of contact. The way practice to the ending of karma should be known. Thus has been said, and in reference to this was it said. Anguttara Nikaya, Book of 6, 63. So, he basically says that completion of the Noble Eightfold Way ends contact, cuts contact. And by this, no intention is formed. And by this, no karma is accumulated. So again, there's four types of karma. Good or bright karma, with bright result. Bad or evil karma, with dark result. Mixed karma, that is both good and bad, bright and dark, with both pleasure and pain, gladness and sadness, bright and dark results. And then there's the karma, the intention to bring about the end of karma, the intention to end karma. This is the fourth time of action. So that is what calls liberation. That is this fourth type of karma, the karma to end karma, the intention to end karma, and what one does for that purpose. That is what is causing liberation. The Buddha said on the ending of karma, and what is the karma that is neither dark nor bright, with neither dark nor bright result, leading to the ending of karma? The intention right there to abandon, leaving behind this karma that is dark, with dark result. The intention right there to abandon, to leave behind this karma that is bright, with bright result. The intention right there on the spot to abandon, to leave behind this karma, this intentional action that is dark and bright, with dark and bright result. This is called the karma that is neither dark nor bright, with neither dark nor bright result, leading to the end of karma. So it's neither good or bad, nor is it dark or bright. It leads to the ending of karma. Again, four types of karma. Good karma, bad karma, something that is both, and something that is neither good or bad, that ends karma. Right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right concentration. That is the karma that leads to the end of karma. Anguttara Nikaya, Book of Force, 235. The awareness, investigation, energy, joy, tranquility, concentration, and equanimity factors of awakening, Sambhuyanga, the seven links to awakening. This is called the Kama that is neither dark nor bright, with neither dark nor bright result, leading to the ending of Kama. Anguttara Nikaya, which you see here, the numerical discourses of the Buddha, Book 4, 238. So this basically means that the entire Noble Eightfold Way and whatever you do of the 37 states of enlightenment, in particular training the seven links to awakening, that is awareness, curious investigation, enthusiastic energy, rapturous joy, tranquility, prasadi, concentration, samadhi, and equanimity, upekka, plus the Noble Eightfold Way. Again, right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right concentration. That is what, ultimately speaking, ends karma. By doing some actions, intentional actions, like meditation, like avoiding doing evil, that is neither dark nor bright, and that has the purpose, specific purpose of ending karma. So it's neither good or bad karma to end karma. It's neither bright nor dark. So remember this fourfold classification of all things. They can be either good, bad, both, or neither. And this is the fourth type of karma that actually leads to liberation. This is its intention and work out the ending of karma by the Noble Eightfold Way and the seven links to awakening. Thank you. Thank you to all the Dayakas and supporters, especially here in Denmark, where the living costs are high. Thank you also to all friends seeing this video. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. And may you indeed have a nice and noble day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Bambarella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.